thanks a lot for inviting me to present this lecture. He has already introduced, I'm practicing in this field for now more than 33 years. And we have done conservation of many structures in Pune and India, and even in some structures abroad also. So today I'm going to present on conservation of heritage structures, a structural engineer's aspect. Normally when we look into conservation principles or basic guidelines, that even as a structural engineer, we are also required to follow these guidelines along with the conservation architect. So first comes is that we must guarantee a structural safety, because structure has to stand stable and safe, because then only people will be able to see that structure and they will have a safe access to that structure. The first aspect is structural safety. Then of course it is followed by we must respect the cultural value of that building. As far as possible, we should have the minimum intervention. So where there is a threat to a safety, that structure may not stand at all. It's only such cases we may go ahead with some moderate or major intervention. But our normal goal is, as far as possible, we try to minimize the intervention. Then whatever intervention we are doing, we should have some principle that as far as possible, there has to be a reversibility of intervention. That means something, if we have added as a later on system or some member, so there should be a possibility of reversible or taking out that intervention. Many times this particular aspect of reversibility of intervention, that becomes very challenging when we are talking of structural repairs, because some of the architectural repairs maybe you can go with reversibility, but when we go with structural repairs, if you are inserting something inside the structure or below the foundation, then many times it becomes very challenging and difficult to have a 100% reversibility in such structural interventions. Then most important, that whatever we are doing structural intervention, that should integrate with the entire building. That as far as possible, it should not pop out as a specific feature that has been introduced and that is totally mismatching with the structure, and it is giving some different look to a structure, or it is changing an entire view of structure. So as far as possible, we should try to avoid this. Whatever the system we are going to have, it should integrate with the entire building. And of course, there has to be a compatibility of materials. Because we all know that when we talk of conserving heritage structures, the materials which are being especially used in all these older structures, mostly they are lime-based, or sometimes even if the structures are old, then there are mud mortars. Then the masonry units, what we have, they are either brick masonry or stone masonry. So whatever the new system or structural repair system we are going to introduce, it should have a compatibility with that earlier older material. And of course, while doing all this, we should try to minimize the cost. Now when we start actually a conservation, the task what we have in front of us is very complex, and it's very totally different than the normal what we go ahead with the new structure or designing a new building. When we go ahead with designing a new building, it's very simple. Whatever system we are designed, put it into computer, whatever computer gives you a data, give that as a drawing for release for construction. In case of heritage conservation, it's reverse engineering. And whenever you go with reverse engineering, it becomes a very complex and challenging task. So first task is that we have to preserve the entire original entity of structure. Then the task is repairing decayed buildings to bring them back to a good health. Again, the main task is that whatever we are doing, to do with the strengthening or rebuilding. There has to be a aim that we should be able to increase the life of that structure. And that entire this process, we are required to do a structural assessment of entire structure, and then we have to give some assurance that after this intervention, the building is going to be more stable as compared to the original building. And then we are required to identify and quantify the extent of damages and what is the repair required. So once we decide these aims, then we have to have an action plan. So for that, we need to acquire some data of the building. Then we have to collect some different detailed surveys. Then we have to do a detailed diagnosis based on whatever data has been acquired. If required, maybe we are required to carry out some tests. Then assessment of entire structural safety. Then design the solution for intervention, and then follow the execution actually at site.
I think actually your voice is getting echoed. I don't know if you can reduce your the speaker mic. Maybe that once you're speaking, so your speaker, I don't know.
Okay, that is getting
okay. Echo is there a bit. If
okay, now it's better.
Now I think it's better. So can you still would like to reduce a bit, or then you will, then we will not be here ever, is something like this.
Hello.
Yeah, now it's okay.
That's okay.
Yes, I don't know. We'll see the feedback after again 5 minutes.
If yes. Fine. So now, if we look at the flowchart of conservation and restoration, the most important first is data acquisition. In that, we have to collect all the historical data. In this, all these consultants will get involved, right from historian or a owner side, or conservation architect, structural designer, geologist, sometimes material specialist. So everyone has to be a part of this entire conservation system. So everyone will try to give his inputs. So first we have to collect all the data related to what is the history. Then we have to survey the structure. Then we have to carry some field assessment. If required, we have to go with some laboratory testing. Sometimes it is required that we monitor that structure for a few months or few days, and then take a call that what is the behavior of that structure, and are there any live movements or some live forces which are acting. So that also sometimes we are required to monitor it. Then when it comes to a structural behavior, then we have to prepare a structural model of that. Then we have to identify the material characteristics. Then we have to identify what are the actions, that is, what are the loads which are presently acting on that particular building, and then prepare a model of that entire structure. Once we prepare this, then we have to diagnose and do an analysis part. So when we do analysis part, we require the data. Both it will be a qualitative data and it will be a quantitative data also. So whenever we go ahead with a structural audit, so structural audit is nothing but a clinical observation which will have some qualitative analysis. Then it will be followed by some non-destructive tests or some destructive tests, partial destructive tests. So that will give some quantitative data. So based on this both data what has been acquired, then we have to do a analysis. Again, that analysis will be a qualitative and a quantitative analysis. Sometimes it is required based on the preliminary analysis report that we should go ahead with some experimentation at site. And then that experimental analysis is done. To give you an example, suppose we are going to do a restoration of a stone masonry building or a brick masonry building which is having some peculiar shapes of that material, because older bricks, they used to be called as book size bricks. They used to be much thinner, So maybe we have to generate all these, we have to do some mock trial at site. We have to have a lime mortar, and we have to manufacture these bricks matching with the older. And sometimes we do a mock trial, we construct some small masonry, and then we take a call that how it's performing and what problems we are going to face with that mock trial, and then we go ahead. Sometimes we are required to do some experimental analysis. We are required to place some loads on structure and then monitor that what are the deflections or is there any crack movement, and then take a call that how structure is responding to what we are planning. So that's why we require sometimes the experimental analysis also. And once we decide this everything, that once we do a total extensive survey and study, then we come out with the remedial measures. The remedial measures for masonry or timber structure or iron and steel structures could be different. Even now, some of the structures which are constructed in the reinforced concrete, now they are also coming as a heritage structure, because now RCC, or especially cement, is being used now almost for more than 120 to 150 years. So now cement is also now becoming a heritage material. And even reinforced structures also, the RCC structure, it has started being practiced all over the world somewhere around almost 100-120 years back. In India also, reinforced masonry, reinforced structures, or even reinforced masonry structure for that matter. Presently, we are doing one conservation of reinforced masonry structure. It's an institutional building. So now even reinforced structures are also going to be a heritage structure, and we will have to restore and repair all these reinforced structures also.
If you can bring your mic a bit closer to your mouth, sir. Mic.
Just
we are just
testing. Just wait for a second.
Yeah.
Yeah, is it better now?
Maybe. Yes. Yeah, just keep the mic a bit closer, sir, to your mouth then.
Yeah. Now?
Yes. We'll see, sir. You can proceed.
Okay, just a minute. If there are some controls for sound, let me check.
I don't think that, okay, here you can.
Yeah, now I try to change the speaker. Now it's better or is it same? Or it is worsened?
It is worsened, sir. You can keep it default only. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Now it's okay?
Yeah, yeah. We move ahead, sir. We move ahead. Yes.
Yeah. So the first most important step when we start doing a conservation is visual inspection. And many times it is called as NDE, that is non-destructive examination. So when we talk of NDE, it includes both. It includes the visual observation, that is a structural audit, which normally we call that as a clinical observation, and followed by some non-destructive tests like the pathological tests doctor will carry out. So when we go ahead with the condition survey, it includes the inspection and assessment of foundations, checking if there are any settlements, and identifying mechanical damages, cracks, splits, then identifying if there are any decays with the material, seepages, dampness, and then if it is a timber structure, then many times we have noticed that there are issues related to termites and wet rotting. So that also we need to identify. Along with this visual observation, we are required to do the assessment or measurement of plumb, line, level, deflections of members. So all these data we are required to collect. So these are a few examples where we have worked. So over here you will see that this column is out of plumb, and you will see that this is almost out of plumb by 3 inches, 75 mm. So it's a quite sizable tilt in the column. Sometimes you will see that there is a deflection or settlement of this particular column, or there are some deflections in the beams. So that also we are required to measure. Then we have to map the defects of the structure, like mapping of cracks, mapping of the direction of crack, width of crack, locations of crack. Then we need to identify whether these cracks are structural cracks or non-structural cracks. If these cracks are structural, then whether they are because of compression or tension or flexure or torsion or settlement. So we need to classify all these manifestations which structure is showing. Sometimes if the cracks are live, so that also we need to identify that whether crack is live or it's dead. So for that, we have to monitor a structure for a certain period. Maybe we can use some glass tapes or telltales which we can fit over the cracks, and we can monitor these cracks for some period, and then we can take a call whether the crack is live or it's a dead crack. Then along with that, we need to identify the leakages, or if there are damages with the masonry or with the individual units, or if there are some decays, if there are some breakages. So all these we need to map on a drawing. So once our clinical observation, that is structural audit, is complete, then normally we follow with the non-destructive test or non-destructive testing. This is very important because in first assessment, what we are going to do is going to be a qualitative analysis, so which we need to support with some quantitative assessment, and for this various non-destructive tests are carried out. Very simple, starting from a simple tapping survey using say timber mallet or a steel mallet, we can simply do a tapping survey. Even the ringing sound, that also gives you some preliminary information about the structure. Then we can use different non-destructive techniques such as rebound hammers, ultrasonic pulse velocity test, infrared thermography, impact echo, radar or ground penetrating radar, flakjack test, core test, vibration measurement, endoscope or bore scopes, and crack monitoring scopes. So these are some of the pictures what we use for non-destructive testing. So these are different types of rebound hammers which are used for non-destructive testing. What you see in picture, there are a number of rebound hammers available with different impact energies. The rebound hammers used for concrete are different. Rebound hammers which are used for bricks are different. Rebound hammer used for mortars, they are different. So this particular hammer is used normally for bricks and mortars. So even this is a hammer which is used for measuring the strength of mortar. There are different hammers available in market, so we have to select a right hammer. Here the rebound hammer is being used on a timber column. Here the rebound hammer is used on a masonry mortar. Here it is used on brick. Here it is used on stone masonry and masonry joints. Similar to this, there is a very powerful instrument, which is an ultrasonic pulse velocity instrument. This you can use extensively, again, on timber structures. So here he is measuring the ultrasonic velocity across the member. So this is called as a direct measurement. If the opposite face is not accessible, then we have to go with measurement on one side. This is the indirect method. So with use of ultrasonic, you can identify the quality of that timber. Then you can use the micro drill test. You can measure the resistance of timber to the drilling, and then you can plot the different graphs, and then you can identify that what quality of timber you have. So this could be a soft timber. Here you can see it's a good quality timber. If there is some cavity in between, then you will see that there is almost zero resistance. So you can easily identify the quality of timber and the voids at exact locations. Then you can use a ground penetrating radar, which is a very powerful instrument. This is used for almost in many techniques, many fields like RCC, stone, brick masonry, or timber structure. With GPR, you can identify whether there are voids or internal defects. You can have a 3D tomography of this. You can identify the thicknesses of that. And then you can inspect and analyze old structure and monuments, especially with this. There are different frequency antennas which are available, which can scan right from, say, a few inches. And even up to in soil, you can go even up to around, say, 20, 30 meters deep inside. So ground penetrating radar is a very powerful tool. If you want to identify that what is the present strength of a masonry, which is a very challenging or very very much required information, then you go ahead with the analysis of structure. So in such case, you are required to do a flatjack test, wherein two slots are made in masonry and these flatjack plates are inserted and they are inflated with the hydraulic pressure, and then you measure the in situ strength of that particular masonry. So this is a very powerful tool for measuring the in situ strength of stone masonry. Then you have some impact echo testers also. These are very similar to the ultrasonic, but here they work on echo principle. And even these instruments also are used, and with these instruments you can identify the thicknesses, you can identify the voids or cracks inside the structure. Then if there are some cracks, then you can use the crack scopes. With the crack scopes, you can use, you can measure the width of crack. And if you are using a ultrasonic, then you can even measure the depth of cracks also. Or simply, if you want to monitor the cracks, then you can use gypsum telltales. We can make a small patch with gypsum across the crack. Or maybe we can use the telltales, acrylic or glass telltales. And with this gypsum telltales, simply you will be able to identify whether the crack is live or dead. If the crack is live, then this gypsum telltales, they will get cracked. With this acrylic slider telltales, you can physically measure that what is the movement in that particular crack, by how much width or how much quantity it has increased. So that is also possible. Then there are some instruments or thermographic cameras. With thermographic cameras, you can identify where are the dampnesses in the walls or what is the temperature movement. So this also becomes very handy tool. But we should remember that when we use a thermographic camera, it's not going to give you anything inside the structure, but it's going to be a surface picture. So what with a normal eye we cannot see, a thermal camera can see much better. This is going to measure the temperature of entire surface with the accuracy of almost 0.1 degree Celsius. So you can identify that if there is a darker spot, so probably here the temperature is lower, almost you can see over here it's 13 and over here the temperature is 20. So that means definitely that there is a dampness over here. So if you take a picture from a longer distance, then you will see in this picture that at these two particular locations, at sill level, the temperature is slightly on low side. So it indicates that there is going to be some dampness or leakages over here. Or you will see that this patch over this patch, at these locations, there is definitely going to be a lower temperature, which indicates that there is probability some leakages or seepages over there. Many times we combine radar and thermography together. And then based on these two methods combining, then we can get some good results. Normally, it is always recommended that whenever we go ahead with some non-destructive test, we should not use only one standalone ND test. But we must combine at least two or preferably three or four methods. So then we can get some more clear picture or idea of that structure. Then even endoscopes are also we are using, because if there is a, some false ceiling or false flooring, then many times we don't know that what is the structural member or structural system which is behind that false floor or false ceiling. So then we use these endoscopes or boroscopes, and then we can take the videos and photos and do the mapping of that structure. Then many times vibration monitoring is also required, because vibration, they create a lot of issues, and vibrations can come from n number of sources. So we must monitor the vibrations, and then we can take a call that what actually the force is creating that vibration, or from where it is coming and how to tackle that. Then comes the most important and very challenging and very difficult aspect is assessment of foundations. Because assessing a superstructure is bit easier and bit simpler, but assessment of foundation, it becomes very much challenging, because sometimes if the foundations are too deep, then excavating to that depth, that becomes very difficult. Many times, if you go with a deeper excavation, and if the adjoining properties are very close, or if the structure is very closely spaced, recently we have done the assessment of one fort in Surat, which is sitting on the bank of the river. So excavation and checking of foundation, it was a very much challenging, it was practically difficult. And we tried to excavate for a quite a large depth, but afterward it was noticed that the foundations are much, much more deeper. So it becomes very challenging that how to assess the characteristics of soil, then what is the water table, then are there any issues like sulfates and chlorides which will have effect on that mortar strength, and what is the possibility of settlement. So for that we are required to do some assessment of foundation. Then once we do this non-destructive testing, then we need to identify that what are the forces which are acting on structure. Of course, the first force which is going to act, it's its own self weight, that is the derivative of that structure. So that also needs to be mapped. So we are required to prepare the all as built drawings. Then measurement of the densities of some of the materials, and then arriving at the deload or self weight of that particular structure. Then we need to identify that what are the live loads. Because in some cases we have seen that the structure earlier it was used as a, some residential building, And then later on, it was acquired by a government department and it was converted into an office. So the original load on that building, probably it was designed for 200 kg per meter square. And presently that structure was being used for almost 400 kg. And at some places we have seen that they have converted the rooms into storage places or converted the rooms into library. The load of library is very high. The load of books is very high. Compared to the residential building, as I'm saying, it's 200 kg per meter square. The load of store material or especially library, it can go as high as even 700 to 1000 kg per meter square. And such increase or changes in load during a time frame, they create many times issue with the structure. So we are required to identify that what are the dead load, what are the live load, is there any change in present use of structure, what has been earlier designed, and because of that changes, are there any distresses in structure, and then how to tackle. Then we need to check the soil movements and soil settlement. Simply because change of water table or some adjoining property, if they have done some excavation, or if they have constructed a very big structure adjoining to this existing structure, then the soil pressure is going to change. And whatever the structure it has been designed, maybe say 100, 200 years back, probably at that time that was the only structure in that area, and if the adjoining area was vacant, and now it has come in city and entire adjoining ground and area has been occupied and it has been loaded with structure, then there is going to be change in the soil pressure. Now we are already observing that water tables are now changing. And they are most of the time now the water tables are going below. And such changes in water table, they also will produce some soil movements and some settlement. Recently we have seen a small town, there was a structure and that structure was showing some movement and tilt of about 3 inches to 4 inches. And that was a challenge, that why that tilt is coming. And first we did the audit of that particular structure. And once we audited the structure, we found that the problem is not a localized problem. And probably there is a much more wider movement of soil. And that's why we did the recognition survey of that entire lane, covering almost around a 200 meter length. And then we were surprised that all the structures in that entire length, they had started settling. And the movement of the soil settlement was the order of the tilting structure. They were of the order of almost some of the structures were tilted right from 1 inches to a maximum of about 4 to 5 inches. So the problem was not localized to that particular structure. So it has transferred to the entire adjoining area. And that was mainly because of a lot of changes in that entire lane. The earlier there used to be hardly 3-4 structures, and now that entire lane was having structures more than 100. Then, so there was a change in soil pressure. Then there was change in water table also. So this has created the movements in soil. So that becomes very complicated and challenging stuff. Then we need to assess that what are the thermal movements. So for that, the thermal camera that comes to help. So with thermal camera, maybe you can take the images at night, you can take the images in the afternoon with the changes in temperature, how the structure is moving, behaving, or is there any live movement because of thermal movement. And thermal movements can be even with the say season. In winter, the temperature will be lower. In summer, the temperature will be much higher. So all these materials, they will expand and contract or shrink with a different speed. So we need to assess that what are the thermal movements and how they are behaving and how they are interacting with the each other material. Because the timber will move, expand and contract at different speed. And stone masonry will expand contact at a different speed. If it is a brick masonry, then it will expand contact at a different speed. And when we have the combinations of all these materials, then we need to identify that how the forces are getting developed because of these temperature changes. Then we need to monitor creep in timber. And similarly, shrinkages in mortar. Because once we go ahead with the intervention and your older structure has already shrunk, your brick masonry and lime mortar and whatever mortar you have used, it has already shrunk and it has already undergone a longer creep and longer shrinkage. And once now we intervene in between and we try to remove a small portion of the brick masonry and we are going to replace with a new one, then we should know what are the properties, what is the material behavior, that how much new material is going to shrink or expand, and what are going to be the effects of this shrinkage or expansion on the parent material. So we should monitor that it should not harm the parent material. And reverse way, it should not have an effect that the new material what we have introduced, it has now shrink, and after shrinkage, maybe maybe down the line after say 3 or 4 months, then you notice the shrinkage cracks. So we should try to avoid all these aspects. Then of course there are other forces also which act on structure, like earthquake, wind, hurricanes, floods, vibrations, blasts, and even for that matter vegetation. The growth of trees or vegetation, that also induces a lot of pressure and a lot of stresses on the building. And most of the time, as the buildings are not maintained properly, then you will see that there is a growth of vegetation and the root size will go on increasing, and then it will put a pressure on that structure. So like even other forces, even vegetation also can induce a lot of pressure on the structure. And as you are aware that earthquake science, earthquake engineering science, still we say that still it is in infant stage. Still many of the things of earthquake, we are not able to clearly identify and quantify and put it in some equations. So still some data is being gathered, and earthquake engineering science is being now getting developed in last year around 100 years. And most of the structures what we saying heritage structures, they will be having age say more than 100 years or 200-300 years. And at that time, the knowledge of earthquake was definitely, earthquake engineering was definitely not known, and people were using or modifying the structural systems based on the past experiences. And with their past experiences, sometimes they have done mistakes also. Because you will see that because of earthquake, many times when we especially see to give an example of a temple, during earthquake, you will see that the garbhagriha, most of the time, it will not get damaged. Or if at all it has some damages, there will be some local damages or some minimum damages. But during earthquake, you will see that the sabha mandap, most of the cases either they have collapsed or they have faced a severe damages. So in a temple you will see that there are two side by side structures or part of structures. One resists the earthquake, but second part it doesn't resist the earthquake. And the simple philosophy first what we should understand with earthquake, that earthquake, when we see a force which is going to act on a structure, force is equal to mass into acceleration. So mass is the weight of your entire structure. So it is straightway proportionate to the mass of structure. So more you have weight of your structure, more is going to be the force acting on your structure. So normally, if you want to make a building stable for earthquake, as a structural engineer, we try to make that building as light as possible. So we try to reduce the weight of that structure because force is going to be directly mass into acceleration. But you will see that all the older structures, all the heritage structures, they have very thick walls or very thick flooring, and that's why the dead weight of all older structure is much more. There are two aspects. One is dead weight of that structure. So that creates an issue, because as the weight increases, if you have a stone masonry, then stone is more denser, so it will have more weight compared to your brick masonry. So more the weight, more the force on structure, which is undesirable. But if we look at the example what I was giving, the example of a temple where the garbhagriha it stands and the sabha mandap it collapses during earthquake. The reason of this particular problem is that if you look at the garbhagriha, the shape of garbhagriha is going to be much stable, and it's not going to be any complex shape. The shape of garbhagriha is going to be a rectangle, square, or round, or octagonal. So it's going to be a very safe and stable shape. Plus, the most important, if you look at the footprint area, in new terminology, suppose we calculate the carpet ratio to built-up ratio. In garbhagriha, you will see that the thickness of wall is quite high. And if you calculate the total built-up area, outside area, and the carpet area inside, you will see that carpet area is almost 50% of the total built-up area. That means 50% of the wall is touching directly with the ground. So footprint of a garbhagriha is substantially high. It's almost 50%. And more is the contact area of your structure with the ground, more the footprint, the structure is going to be more stable. And that's the main simple reason that why garbhagriha normally do not have any major damages during earthquake, because the footprint of all these structures, garbhagriha, they are almost 50-60% or even more than that. Even if you take the example of Taj Mahal, the footprint of Taj Mahal is almost more than 50%. So that is the basic reason why it's standing even during the earthquakes. Second, the shapes, as I'm saying, they are very simple. They are either circle or rectangle or octagon. So there is no torsion which is getting developed because of the complex shape. So that is the main reason why the garbhagriha stands. And if you look at the sabha mandap area, in sabha mandap area, you will see that the carpet to built-up ratio, there are only columns, timber columns or stone columns, and you have very wider open area to accommodate the people. So that's why the footprint of the sabha mandap is hardly around 10 to 15% max. In some of the cases, even the footprint of the sabha mandap is hardly around 5 to 7%. Where you have only columns, where you don't have any walls, then the footprint of the sabha mandap, it becomes hardly say, even 3 to 5%. And then these structures, they become very challenging for earthquake. And now over that, if you have a very thick flooring or a very thick roofing system, then it is going to vibrate much in earthquake. And all these structures, most of them, they are simply supported structures. They don't have a proper, truly fixity at the joints. And that's why there is a hinge formation, or already the structure is hinged, and then it collapses because of the earthquake. So earthquake becomes very challenging because most of our old structures, they are not designed at all for earthquake. And now if you are thinking to restore these structures for earthquake with the new philosophy what we have, or the new knowledge what we have with earthquake, that becomes very, very challenging. Same is the case with wind, because wind also is a dynamic force. And earlier also, people have tried to learn from the failures, and that's how they have constructed these structures. But now with the availability of now knowledge, this is becoming very challenging, that how we restore these structures for these forces. So just to give an example over here, I am showing some pictures over here. This is Parag Mahal in Bhuj. So this is a picture before, and this is a picture after earthquake. So most of the structure, it has properly damaged. Over here also, you will see that some of the structures over here standing, these are Garbhagriha. And rest of the structures, they are totally collapsed. These are typical movements which will create the diagonal cracks in the load-bearing structure. And if it is a load-bearing structure, then the earthquake movement is very critical. We need to make the structure stable or introduce some system in this older structure to enhance its earthquake resistance. Remember that in earthquake science, we always say that you cannot make any structure earthquake proof. Because the moment we say earthquake proof, that means we are expecting that there is not going to be an even crack and there is not going to be any collapse anywhere. Only that structure can be called as an earthquake proof. So practically, this is impossible. What we can make a structure is earthquake resistant. So we can increase the resistance of these older structures to a somewhat extent. But again, as I'm saying, that there is a limitation. When we design a new building, everything is free. We can introduce whatever system we want. We can change a framing system, a load bearing system, and we can make the structure earthquake resistant. But the structure which is already constructed and which is not a earthquake resistant, to convert that structure to an earthquake resistant, that is very difficult. And most of the time, we are required to do some compromise and accept that the structure cannot be made even fully, truly earthquake resistant. But maybe we try to introduce some systems by which at least we can increase the basic weaknesses and try to increase the resistance to earthquake. As I said, that the vibrations on structure, the vibration can be because of the earthquake also. It can be because of the wind also. It can be because of even a simple vehicle moving on the road. It can be because there is some activity which is going adjoining to your property and some construction work is being done, or a metro construction is being done, or even a metro is passing through underground. Or even for that matter, the people are walking on a structure. So all this, they can create the vibration. And vibrations are very difficult to tackle. And even the measurement also, it becomes very challenging, measurement of vibration. And then assessing the exact sources from where the vibrations are coming, that also becomes challenging. Because some of the vibrations which are being created inside building, maybe you can control, but you cannot control the movement which is going outside. If a truck is passing on a road and if that is creating a vibration, how you can stop the movement of trucks? So then you need to make, you are required to make, that structure should have some resistance, or we should try to see that we increase the resistance of that structure for such vibration. So that becomes a very interesting part. Then, as I said, that growth of vegetation, that gives enormous forces on the structure. And most of the older structures, you will see that there is a growth of big trees over there. And because of some, say, historical or some values, many times people don't allow even to remove or cut these trees. And then you will see that it has totally damaged this wall. You will see that many times we have the trees and creepers over the structure. In one of case where we had did this investigation, we have seen that there was a movement and that has created the tilts in structure, and almost the width of these tree roots, they have become so wide, almost thick as 1 inch to 3 inches thick. And they have created a lot of cracks in this structure. You will see that all these cracks what you see over here, even in arches, they were simply because of the tree roots which have traveled. Normally we have observed that even a and most of the time a typical common tree will be a peepal tree. So if you have a peepal tree of height of hardly 2 to 3 feet, you'll be surprised that the roots of 3 to 4 feet height peepal can travel about a length or say height of around 30 to 50 feet. Almost we have seen the length of or height of roots is around 10 to 15 times the height of your actual tree, what you see on a structure. And then it becomes challenging that how you remove these tree roots. Many a times people try to cut the roots or the tree just at the edge of wall. That is not going to help, because the tree, like a peepal, normally that has got a bulb just inside the wall. And that bulb, unless until you are not removing the bulb, the tree is going to again have its growth next 10 years, next monsoon. So we must remove that bulb. And when we take a call of removal of that bulb, then we are required to do some extensive intervention. Maybe you have to remove that wall entirely and again reconstruct, and then remove that bulb and all the tree roots. In this particular structure, we are at many places we have removed the walls. We have marked all the stones and we have removed the walls, and we are seeing that tree roots have traveled almost 30, 40, 70 feet. And then we are required to remove that entire tree root, and then we reconstructed this structure. So then there are some forces acting like physical, chemical or biological actions. Material decay, mainly because of water. That is the main culprit, that whenever you have an entry of water, whenever there are leakages from your walls or roof, then it's going to decay the material. And water can come from n number of sources, mainly the rain, then humidity, then groundwater, then wetting and drying cycles, and most important is not listed is the leakages from structure itself. Because in all these structures, as the structures have been used by different people and for different purposes, at many places inside these structures there will be some toilets, new toilets, and they will leak or they will have the seepages, and that water will try to decay the material. And the material decay mainly it's going to affect the timber members, because of the water, it's going to be a weight rotting, and there will be a substantial damage to timber members. Then, as I earlier explained, that there is going to be a variation in temperature. So there is going to be expansion and contraction, and this expansion and contraction will also put some forces on that structure. So we need to identify. Then microclimatic conditions also. The earlier temperature or earlier climatic conditions were different. Now because of pollution, now there is a lot of carbon dioxide. So if there is a CO2, then carbon dioxide, there will be some carbonation process. Sometimes it will help, but sometimes it will create problem. Then there will be surface deposition because of the pollution from atmosphere. Because of that, your stone will get black, your brick masonry will get black. We are required to remove that deposition. Then sometimes changes in wind speed, because earlier it was say on an open terrain, say a small structure which was constructed, on a small hill, and at that time the wind was blowing from almost all the sides. And now the new structures, multi-story structures, now they have come. So normally we think that they will dilute the wind pressure. Yes, to some extent they will dilute, but they will create the tunnels also. So there will be a new different wind movement within narrow lane. The wind will be passing, and in such case the wind pressure on the wind velocities will be different. and they may create some vortices or vortexes on that structure. So microclimatic conditions that also impact or give the load on the structure. Along with that, fire. Again, if you are seeing that the all older structures which are constructed in timber, timber is very say susceptible to catch a fire. So then we need to check that how to make the structure stable for fire. Then there could be microclimatic changes and which will have some oxidation effect or carbonation effect. So that also is going to induce some stresses on structure. So now if we see now the different structure based on its type of construction. So first if we see the masonry structures, most of the masonry structures we are used either bricks or stone. And as we know that compared to all other materials, the stone and brick masonry, they are a very low tensile strength. They will have a good compressive strength capacity, but the tensile strength of the brick and stone masonry is very, very low. So that becomes challenging when we have some torsion or some moments which are being created by say wind or earthquake. So that becomes very challenging to make a masonry stronger in tension. And I will show you some of the features how we can try to increase the tensile strength of that masonry. Most of the time what we are seeing that the main cause of collapse are basically because of vertical loads only, and that is because of crushing, buckling and brittle failure. Maybe the parent material has become weak or it has lost its strength. Many times we have seen that the older structures where we have used the lime mortars, over a period sometimes they lose the strength substantially. And in such case, simply because of even your dead load, that is vertical load, which is acting on structure, the structure, it starts showing damages and disturbances. And keeping the earthquake apart. Earthquake, yes, definitely that is going to create a much more disaster. But apart from earthquake, because earthquake is going to happen once in, say, few decades. It's not going to be a regular action on that structure. But the vertical self weight or dead weight and lie load, it's going to be acting on that structure every day, every time. So we should be very careful even taking this structure even for dead load and lie load also. We have to give a lot of attention, especially when there are cavity wall structures or rubble filled masonry or veneer brick walls, which have a very poor quality core. And the action of these walls or the capacity to resist the forces of such cavity walls or filled composite masonry walls is normally less compared to a standalone brickwork or a stone masonry work. So again, these are some of the pictures. This is Pune's very famous Vishrambagh Wada, which was the residence of Bajirao Peshwa. So this is a load-bearing structure which is constructed in brick masonry. Later on, this structure was taken over by Pune Municipal Corporation. As I said, that this was earlier used as a residential, but later on, Corporation Pune Corporation, it started its operations in Pune in 1930s in this particular structure. So the building, which was supposed to take a load of 200 kg, was now for a period of around almost 20-30 years was used as an office. And then they created a lot of structures touching this. They created some toilet blocks over here. And you will see in that picture that this toilet has damaged this brickwork totally. And because of the seepages, there are some movements in the soil which are creating these diagonal cracks and some movement in the structure. And simply they were big because of the structures which we have constructed adjoining or touching this particular building and they were not maintained properly, and they created a lot of stresses on the building. Then these are typical stresses which can be seen in stone masonry, and especially arches, that there is a total sometimes over here you will see that even the keystone has dislodged and it has moved, and this particular movement was because of the vegetation. Because of vegetation, the vegetation tried to make a gap between these two stones. It tried to say give a horizontal force and try to move away the arch, and by that this keystone has started dropping down. Then simply because of the weathering action, because of the age, your stone can start losing its capacity, and by weathering ultimately stone will also, as it goes under weathering action, it will ultimately become a soil. So what kind of stone is being used for that particular structure, it will depend on that. If the structure is very soft, a stone is very soft, then it will decay very fast. But if it is say a basalt or other stone, then it will have a lesser deterioration. Laterite, maybe it will have a faster deterioration. Now these are typical structural cracks. The stone you will see over here, the stone is getting cracked, and this is because of the pressure which is being developed on that stone masonry. It could be because of n number of reasons. As I said, it could be because of simple even self weight, that is dead weight live load, or it could be because of some changes what we have done in structure during last few years, which has created some additional stresses in that member, and now the stone has, with the aging effect, it has reduced its compressive strength capacity, and now this becomes a structural crack. That stone has cracked in compression. Then these are typical cracks in the brick walls. Sometimes there is a movement in the brick wall. The two walls, they are trying to go apart, and that's why in brick wall you will see most of the time these are the typical cracks what we see in brick wall. And say flat arch flooring or very small, you can say rise arches, there also you can see that they have a crack. So these are the structural cracks. Now what I was talking about the composite masonry. Now over here you will see on one side there is a brickwork, on opposite side there is a stone masonry, and in between they have filled up with a composite material, brick and stone. So in this case we have seen that there was a much wider crack over here, and once we took a call that we should identify that what is the capacity of that particular wall, we tried to just simply tap the wall, and it was standing almost on the verge of collapse. And simply we tapped with a small hammer, wooden hammer, then the entire wall it started collapsing, because the inner core portion was terribly weak. And that is most of the time it happens when we construct the composite walls, that or infill walls, the inner material normally it does not have any good type of stone or brick. Some pieces or broken pieces are used. The mortar joints in this feeling, they are very thick. Normally the thickness of mortar joint should be as thin as possible, because that is your weakest link in your structure. So as far as possible, we should try to reduce the mortar thickness. And if it is a infilled wall or filled wall, then you will see that all the material inside, it will have quite a lot of mortar, thick mortar, even 2 to 3 or 4 inches thick mortar. And then it is not a good material. Then some lateral movements over here. The property, adjoining property holder, he started raising the floor or the soil. So earlier soil on the adjoining side was somewhere at hardly 1 or 2 feet, but later on he went on filling his property and he reclaimed his plot almost up to a 5 feet. And because of that, the soil pressure increased, and then it started putting a pressure on that compound wall, which was not supposed to take that load. Or sometimes you can see that earthquake, how it can create the shaking and how it can create totally disaligned the structure. And from the moment here itself, we will see that earthquake is a reversible force, it's a reciprocating force. So there is a movement both the sides within a fraction of second, the ground moves in opposite directions. So it's a reversible of stresses within a fraction of second. And that is very difficult for structure to resist such reversible of stresses. Now if we see this timber structures, most of the time the timber structure, they act as a boat. They are used in both load bearing structure and even as a standalone frame structure. The durability of what kind of timber is being used, that depends on method of harvesting, method of seasoning, and method of conversion. So when we are talking of new timber which we are going to replace, we must identify that what is the source of that particular timber, from where it is coming, how it has been harvested, what is the quality of that particular timber, is it properly seasoned? Because most of the timber what you get presently in market is not properly seasoned. In hurry, they are simply pushing all the timber in market, which is totally unseasoned. And then it is bound to create the problem in your structure, because as this is not seasoned, the moisture of that timber is going to be much more higher. And then as over a period, that moisture is going to get lost, then there are going to be cracks in the and splits in the timber members, and even there could be an attack of termites. A very good tool what we can use, NDP, as a quality control tool, which we are using in almost our all heritage conservation projects. We are using the non-destructive test, that is Ribbon Hammer and ultrasonic, especially ultrasonic instrument. Whenever we procure a new timber for replacement or strengthening of existing, then first we assess that timber with this ultrasonic pulse velocity test. And now we have created a database for different type of timbers, that if it is a properly seasoned timber, then what velocity that timber will have. So normally we have a practice that whenever a contractor procures a timber, then first, before putting it at site, we check each and every member with ultrasonic testing. And we have some predefined norms. If that particular timber passes that predefined velocity criteria, only then and then that timber is allowed to be used at site. Otherwise, simply we reject and we ask that contractor to bring another good timber. So that's how NDT can be used even during quality control for during a new construction or restoration work. And of course, as we know, for timber, the fungal and insect attack, that is going to be the very important, which is going to deteriorate that structure. Termites are going to deteriorate. High moisture content and temperature, they are going to create again, more the moisture, more you have, will have the termite, and more there will be wet rotting also. And most of the time you will see that the older structures, as they are not maintained properly, they will have a lot of deterioration. And in timber structures, there are 3-4 problems normally what you will see. First is wet rotting, second is termite attack, third is splits and cracks. And because of the wet rotting or section loss, there will be a shortening of members, especially columns. And once the columns they shorten, then they will simply sink or they will settle, and then they will create the issues on the floor beams. So here in this picture, you will see that this is a load bearing structure having a timber frame. These are the columns. What you see over here? Over here, the entire timber section, it has vanished. Nothing is remaining. It's totally weight rotten. Now you will see that this column is simply resting because of the frictions of the adjoining wall. If we remove this adjoining wall, then this column is going to sink. And even the friction also, this column normally it settles. So this is at floor level. If you see, this is at the plinth level, and if you see at the floor level, the typical peculiar construction over here, you will see that this is a ground floor column. This is a beam. Then here you may have some cross joists. Then above that, this timber column is resting. See over here the thickness of the floor. The thickness of floor is almost 500 to 600 mm thick, which is going to create a lot of dead weight on the structure, unwanted dead weight on the structure. Most of the time, in older days, why people have gone ahead with this such a thick flooring? Because if you have a timber flooring, there will be some vibration and there will be some noise. So to avoid this vibration and to avoid the noise, normally they will have a timber floor at bottom. Then they will fill up this entire material with soil or mud. And then above that, they will have the second layer of your final flooring. It could be either a tile or it could be a timber flooring. But most of the time, there used to be the stone flooring. So that puts a lot of pressure, a lot of weight on structure. And we must remove such loads on structure. And because of the outside, you will see that corbelling and the external features are not being properly maintained during last few years. The column portion over here, it has totally weight rot and it has totally given way. And unless until you open such areas from outside, you may not see anything. It may look like that the upper column is in very good condition, and that's why we may blindly avoid doing anything. And maybe after some time, this will create problem because this was unseen, unopened. So many a times, especially the columns in this area, we have to be very careful. Then weight rotting and termite action, they will damage. You will see that how a wrong repair is being carried out. This is a cantilever bracket. Actually, this is a beam. This beam was supposed to be a one-piece beam. In fact, even this beam was also supposed to be a one-piece beam. Because of the weight rotting and termite, this has totally damaged. And the earlier intervention by a local person was done. He has simply filled up this with a cement mortar. That means a timber member is being partly replaced or partly filled with a mortar. This is not going to help at all, because structurally this has to be a one action. You cannot have something wrong material which is being put inside. This is again some settlement or movement in floor because of the weight rotting. The corner connection of that column and beam, it has totally weight rotten, and that's why beam has given way and the structure has sink. Here also we will notice the floor thickness. Over here the floor thickness was almost 2 feet, 600 mm thick flooring. These are the effects because of termites and weight rotting. Then your beams also will start giving way. Over here you will see that already there is a lot of weight rotting and the timber member has severely damaged and the entire structure has now started deflecting and sinking. Then what I was saying, that the flooring thickness, we should try to remove all these flooring. And in many cases, we have removed this soil filling, and we have filled up either the lightweight material, and if you want to damp the noise and vibration, maybe we can use some thermocol material which can damp. It has to be lightweight, or sometimes we can use the lightweight Siporex material as a filler material in between. Or even if you want to really go with a total conventional material, then we can use a pumice stone. Pumice is a naturally occurring stone which has got a density somewhere around 600 to 800. And the pumice stone, it can float on a water. So this is a natural stone. So maybe if the stone is available in a nearby area, you can simply replace the, instead of brickbat, like you can use the pumice stone ballast over there, and you can fill that area and reduce the weight. Or in one of the case, we have simply totally removed this weight, and we have made the false flooring, and there is a cavity of 200 mm in between. So that is also possible. There are some structures where you have a composite material which is used, and that is a iron or this use of steel, because cast iron and steel is manufactured almost now about 150 to 200 years back. So many of the structures you will see that people have used the cast iron or wrought iron. And then the challenges over here are corrosion. Then many of the time the stresses are generally higher around the holes or fasteners, and from there again the corrosion triggers, or the material starts splitting or breaking. Iron and steel in old buildings, in general, it is less ductile and less resistance to fatigue than normally what steel or iron we have presently. So that is a issue in the older structure. Over here, one of the structure where the steel members were used, this structure is about 130 years old. This is the Pune University building. And when we opened the flooring, we noticed that most of the angles which were used as a flooring, you must be aware that a T section is used as a flooring. In between, a shava tile is placed. In Maharashtra, we call that type of flooring as a kadipat flooring. So this type of flooring is very common, and this you will see almost the structures which are constructed somewhere between say 1850s till even up to 1960 or 70. This type of flooring is being used, and that was very popular flooring. So the issue with this is corrosion. So now when we diagnose the entire building, as I said that this is a very delicate task. And while diagnosing, we should have the correct assessment of available data, correct assessment of NDT results. We should be able to identify the symptoms. I always say that structure, they talk with you. We should be able to, in line with the structure, structure will talk with you. It will start showing his issues and problems. And once we start chasing the cracks, then you will realize then structure will start showing more and more problems. Only we should be able to be in line with the structure. And we should be able to identify the correct symptoms and do the correct root cause analysis or diagnosis of the problem. That becomes very important. Sometimes experience comes plays very important role, or intuition also, that sometimes we get some intuition or some with experience that at this particular location, let me go over there and open that particular location, I'm guessing that there is going to be some problem inside. And because based on your past experience, you may get such guidelines for your further structures. When we do the diagnosis and modeling, what are the challenges? Structural analysis, what we use for new construction or whatever the softwares we have presently, they may not be accurate, not reliable for historical structure. Because most of the softwares what presently being available in market, they are mainly for two types of structure. One is RCC structure and second is steel structure. Because now all new modern structures, we are using only these two types of materials, that is RCC or steel. Hardly any construction, except where we have some specific requirement, we go with load bearing structures. Even nowadays, especially in India, we are not using timber structures. Maybe some region of local tribal areas, maybe Assam or somewhere where bamboo is available, people are going for timber structures, or where wood is plentifully available, maybe in Kashmir or all the north region. But in south region, where the timber availability is not readily available and it is not even been allowed by government, we are not using these materials. And that's why the structural softwares which are presently available, they are not capable of handling these load-bearing structures, and especially they don't have any capability that how to handle the decay and losses or loss in strength of that material, or the changes in materials, or loss of fixity, or if there is a composite material, as I said, if there is a composite wall of brick and stone, or a cavity infilled wall. So all these software, they don't have, truly speaking, a capability of handling all these heritage or historical structures. And then, of course, there is a limitation in assessment of correct physical properties of the material. That is, how to assess the Poisson's ratio or Young's modulus of a masonry, stone masonry. If it is a brick masonry, then it may be a somewhat easier. But if it is a composite masonry, then it becomes very much challenging, and even whatever we NG test we carry out, the results what we are going to get, they are not going to give you the correct properties of the material which we can put as a input data in our software. So when we talk of a modeling and doing a analysis of the historical or old structure, truly speaking, there are a lot of limitations on the correctness or correct assessment or modeling of that structure. Though there are few softwares available, especially for modeling heritage structures, but still there are quite a lot of limitations. Then many times we don't have the correct knowledge about the alterations, repairs carried out in the past material. We are not about correctly aware about how is the joinery of say column and beam, how is the correct joinery of your wall and foundation, what is the foundation on which type of soil it is resting. So there are n number of unknown data, or maybe a incorrect data, which creates a limitation in arriving at the solutions. As we know that some of the definitions, when we say repair means it is an action taken to restore the structure only to its original strength, and it is limited only to the damaged element. So it may include say repairs of wall cracks, or stitching of walls, or maybe grouting of cracks, or repair of non-structural element. So whatever we do, limited to the only damaged portion, and just to restore it to its original strength, that normally we say as a repair. Tunneling is slightly more than a repair. Tunneling means to increase the resistance of the present structural element beyond the value it had. So it's not necessary that we are going to strengthen only the damaged element. Even the structure members which are not damaged, but now we have identified that the capacity of those elements or other structure is less, then we strengthen them. It may include jacketing of members, strengthening of some infill walls. Similarly, a very common terminology is used is a retrofitting. And most of the time, retrofitting terminology is associated with a seismic strengthening. So, many times for seismic strengthening, the retrofitting terminology is used. When we are saying I am doing retrofitting or seismic strengthening, what we are actually doing, the structural modifications to upgrade the resistance, not only resistance, but the strength, ductility, and energy dissipating ability, which was earlier deficient, or maybe because of the earlier earthquake, the structure has now damaged. And now that we want to increase its resistance, strength, ductility, so whatever action we take, that will be called as a retrofitting action. So it may include additions of new members, like addition of shear wall, addition of beams, addition of columns, maybe additions of bracings, or even it may include reducing of load. As I said, that for seismic force, it is take away mass into acceleration. So first action, which is from an active side, all other actions what we are doing, they are from passive side. So the more effective action always, if you take any corrective measure from the active side, that will be more foolproof, that will be more effective, and that will be more long-lasting. So as far as possible, we should try to identify or do a root cause analysis or diagnosis that what are the member forces which are acting on that structure, from where they are acting, how they are acting, and what action or stresses they are creating or what movements they are creating. Once we do a correct root cause analysis and diagnosis, then try to identify that what is the active side wherein we can do some intervention or where we can try to make some changes. And preferably, try to give the solutions from the active side. They are more last long, more durable. Just to give an example, suppose if there is a water tank which is leaking, there could be two options available. First, a simple action from passive side is simply use a plug-in material or a fast setting cement. Just hold that plug-in material in hand from outside and press it on the hood. So immediately within say few minutes, that material that is normally the fast setting cement, it will set within hardly 1 or 2 minutes, and then your leakage will get stopped. So that also is a solution. But I won't say that is a foolproof solution or that is a long-lasting solution. Because the solution, what we are doing, still we are allowing the entry of water, still we are not stopping the leakage which is creating from inside. Simply from outside, we are stopping the water to come out on the surface. A better solution from active side is, from active side, what we should do, first empty the tank, make the hole clean, remove the water, algae, fungus, or whatever inside you have, maybe apply some bonding agent, then fill that material with an expansive grout, that is non-shrink material. Then, over and above, apply a waterproofing treatment from inside, and then you again fill up the tank. So whatever solution you are doing from inside, that is from active side, that is definitely going to be a foolproof. So that's why I am saying that first try to identify that wherever there are some load on the structure which are not required and which are going to create the issue, especially for seismic load, try to reduce as much as possible these loads. So even simply reducing a load, that becomes your retrofitting action. That becomes your retrofitting repair scheme. Similarly, you can increase the ductility. So you can use some different techniques for increasing the ductility.
May I interrupt, sir? Actually, it's already 1 o'clock.
Yeah.
Because the participant will have to have lunch, and then again we have next session at 2:30.
Okay.
So if we can just take up some of the questions, because okay. I know that the kind of knowledge you have is huge.
Yeah.
So that's what, because.
Yeah, fine. Maybe I will show some of the pictures. That how, maybe in the next 2-3 minutes, I will just wind it up.
Yes.
That's how you can either stick the masonry, or you can use the different types of wrap. It can be even glass wrap, FRP wraps. You can use the sticking. Maybe you can use the clamps or staple the wall. Over here, we have stitched the crack with almost a 1.5 meter SS rod we have put inside for sticking this crack. There could be different issues at different levels. So at different level, you can repair the brick arch lintels, repair the cracks, or maybe repair if there are cavities. In one of the projects now, we are using a stainless steel flexible rods for stitching the cracks. So in this arch, we are stitching the cracks like this. So there is a crack over here, so we are going to stitch a crack like this. So simply at a mortar joint will be open, and over here, we are inserting a stainless steel, highly flexible material inside the crack. Even a pointing also can be a major. Tying simply the walls with the tie rods, that can help. An anti-termite treatment, then maybe using a timber joinery. As I said, over here we have totally removed this load, and we have made this entire floor into a cavity floor. Then the challenge main becomes is when it comes to a settlement issue or strengthening of foundation. That becomes very challenging. Sometimes maybe we have to go ahead with the micropiles. Okay. So maybe we can have the questions.